We gather for worship in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
How am I sounding? Sounding kind of like I need a muffin. Thanks for bringing the cookies. If I stand back there, is it better? Oh, here. Is that me? Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Oh, that's a good much better. So you're going to be behind the speaker.
That's what it is.
It's better the farther back I go. There's no way to know it. Anyway, now you know who I am. I'm Noel Westover, and I'm a hospital chaplain at some of us are met. In most circumstances, we've met in church meetings, and we've met in various times and places, and I'm really glad to be here. But it means that Pastor Mark isn't here. So you should be sad that I'm here. I'd like to say thank you to all the people that are involved in service today. To our leader, Karen. She's on here. So does that mean I get to do the reading? Would I be glad to do it? Okay, I'll read. That way I can change the verses. Oh, is it? It's on the screen, maybe? Oh, no. I'm nervous. Okay. Well, I'll read from there. You can follow on the screen. I'd also like to say thank you to Megan and Bob for leading us in the song and worship today. Thank you so much. And God bless your ministry as well. To our ushers, Alice and Aaron, thank you for greeting everyone, and especially for greeting me. When the cost of sleep, it was great to be welcomed the way I was. For Ron, looking after our sound, and we were practicing this morning, just kind of fills the place with praise and spirit. And to you, Vince, for looking after a PowerPoint again and my sound and just being such a hospitable guy. And also there are some anniversaries that we're celebrating here in the church today. Shane and Heather, I don't know you, so if you're there, you can wave to me. Louie and Winona, and Mark and Heather who are away, so and Bob and Bob. So it's this week, it's not today. So yeah, Bob and the most practice. Yeah, it's called God is Love. It's the third day. And I think it's the last day of July, isn't it? Yeah, that's right. So I'm going to acknowledge the Lord. Also, this week just passed. On the Lutheran calendar, there were a number of anniversaries. We remembered James, the apostle. He wasn't the first Christian martyr. Stephen was that James was the first of the apostles to be a martyr's death. And you can read about that in the book of Acts and the chapters. It's really quite a story. James, you remember him? And so that day was dressed in the band, lit as the pulpit, seat of the church. And then this week also, we remember three church musicians. And along with them, we remember all church musicians, including these three. Bach, Schutz, and Handel. Listen to any Bach lately? If you listen to rock and roll, listen to a lot of Bach, because he was the inventor of the wall of sound. Just non-stop sound. So those guys remember. Then we remember Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. Remember that story in the New Testament? Lazarus died, and Jesus went and all of us were grave, and Mary and Martha, his sisters, they had a meeting with Jesus before all that happened, remember? Martha got a little upset that she was doing all the hospitality work. Mary was sitting there soaking in the word, and it's Mary's and Martha's. And we also remember any of our legions in this crowd. There's a few, okay, one. And one honorary. I was made an honorary legion in my first year in Saskatoon because they needed someone to make less. You know what left set is in this congregation? Well, you certainly do. So that I was born in Germany and put it in left set. Anyway, I have a certificate. You are an honorary Norwegian. King Olaf, saint, and the first Christian king of Norway. Yeah, and did amazing things to spread Christian faith. So a lot of anniversaries. But what is something? Why did we get up and come to church today? Why didn't we do it on Thursday or Tuesday or Monday? We because today was so special on Sunday. We are actually celebrating today. Jesus rose on the first day of the week. I know the calendar has Sunday as the last day of the week most of the time, but it's really the first day. And Sunday is a parable. It's a parable of the kingdom of heaven, that God rules over all, because it's on Sunday, the first day, that God claimed all of the week, the whole time. So we start the week in worship. We start the week calling on the presence of God, and we carry that through in the Spirit of God all day long. So let's turn to the opening dialogue. Begin in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your glory through Jesus Christ, our Lord. We say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, it is faithful and just. We'll forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Please rise as you stand in God's presence. We confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have done. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk on your ways, to the glory of your holy name. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, it is my privilege to declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. That is something to sing praise for.
Thank you.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the Father, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Because he walked before you in faithfulness righteousness and an uprightness of heart toward you. And you have kept for him this great and steadfast love, and have given him a son to sit on his throne today. And now, O Lord my God, you have made your servant king in place of my father David, although I am only a little child. I do not know how to go out or come in. And your servant is in the midst of the people whom you have chosen, a great people, so numerous they cannot be numbered or counted. Give your servant, therefore, an understanding mind to govern your people, able to discern between good and evil. For who can govern this, your great people? It pleased the Lord that Solomon had asked this. God said to him, because you have asked this, and have not asked for yourself long life or riches, or for the life of your enemies, but have asked for yourself understanding to discern what is right, I now do according to your word. Indeed, I give you a wise and discerning mind. No one like you has been before you, and no one like you shall arise after you. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Second lesson is from Romans in the New Testament, chapter 8, verses 26 to 29, and 26 to 39. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we ought, but that very Spirit intercedes with sighs too deep for words. And God, who searches the heart, knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to God's will. We know that all things work together for good for those who love God, who are called according to his purpose. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that he might be the firstborn within a large family. And those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. What then are we to say about these things? If God is for us, who is against us? He who did not withhold his own Son, but gave him up for us all, will he not with him also give us everything else? Who will bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? It is Christ Jesus, who died, yes, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all day long. We are accounted as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers nor height nor depth nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Say together Psalm 119.
Stay in my steps to the world.
Let's turn to our gospel acclamation. Seek ye first in the tree of life.
To be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that he might be the firstborn of
within a large family. Those whom he predestined, he also called. Those whom he called, he also justified. Those whom he justified, he also glorified. O Lord, your merciful ears are always open to the prayers of your servants, so that our petitions to you may be obtained. Help us by your Spirit to ask for what pleases you. Open our hearts and minds to you, that we may live in harmony with your will and receive the gifts of your Holy Spirit. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Help in our weakness. Prayer in the Holy Spirit. I'm the chaplain for Luminous. It used to be called the Lutheran Care Society. We had to change the name because there was too much confusion between Lutheran Care Society and Luther Care Communities. Luther Care Communities is a very, very big organization with many millions of dollars in assets. And the Lutheran Care Society is a tiny, tiny little organization with no assets. Well, some think I'm an asset, but I'm really the liability. But it's a hospital chaplaincy. We call it Luminous. And our mission has always been to let the light of Christ shine in dark places. So luminosity and luminous and light and all that kind of stuff goes well with that. And this Bible passage about the weaknesses certainly resonates with what we do at hospital chaplaincy, because we encounter there every kind of weakness that can be encompassed by that word. And we also see the Spirit of God addressing and speaking all of those weaknesses. First, there's physical weakness. That's the most common, of course, that we see in the hospital. People suffering with chronic acute illnesses that come up again and again and again for relief to the hospital, at least for their symptoms. They're the core of my congregation. My congregation, all those people on the lists that are sick that day that happen to be Lutheran, that's about between 30 and 60 people. I don't get to see them all, just like your pastor can't get around to see you every day and only comes and visits a couple a day. I try my best to see as many as possible, but I can't see them all. But there are always a few on that list that I've seen before and before and before, because they have a chronic weakness. Maybe it's the heart and lung system. Maybe it's the mental system. Maybe it's the joint system. Maybe it's COPD or rheumatoid arthritis or something like that. We all have a weak physical nature. Even the strongest of the strong, right? There's something that goes wrong. And these with the chronic illness, I get to know them pretty well and at some depth over many visits together. But there's another kind of physical weakness that happens in the hospital, and that's the weakness that results from medical intervention. In a disease process, or a cancer, or tumors removed, or like in my case, a big polyp from my intestines, or we have to have heart surgery, or something like that. Those interventions leave us very weak. Sometimes so weak we can't even breathe on our own. So tubes are put down, and all kinds of monitors are attached, and you get the picture you've maybe seen on television, or you've been there yourself. I find that in our goal-oriented society, both the patients and the medical community as a whole underestimate the actual time that it takes and the patience required to recover from these medical interventions. It is miraculous that 24 hours after having your heart taken out, some changes made to it, put back in, you're off life support in a regular hospital bed. That's nothing short of miraculous. But to be discharged from the hospital within 5 days might be foolish. That's the norm nowadays. It's unbelievable how much recovery has to take place on your own. You have to give yourself a lot more time than anybody tells you. Twice as much, probably. People need time to recover from the smallest things that change in their lives. So how much more do we need for the mental, physical, and spiritual, and emotional healing for those big traumas that take place in our lives? I spend time offering my listening skills and my open heart, soul, to facilitate people to help recover from something as small as a change of roommate in the hospital. It can be very distressing for me to walk in and the patient says, "My roommate changed last night." Gradually, I've come to know what that means. Maybe somebody knows what that means too, especially for a nurse. Somebody died in the bed next to them that night. Now they have a new roommate. Or there was some kind of trauma, and they were part of that trauma, and no one thinks about how that trauma affected them. Long, sleepless nights, long used medications are actually taken away, and you don't know where you're at anymore in your own body. Or you get some news, and it fuels the imagination, and you're totally out of whack in our minds. You know what we're talking about. And there's another kind of weakness, too. There's a social weakness that we administer to in the hospital as well. Because hospitalization means social changes. You lose your personal power. You lose your dignity. You can't make decisions for yourself anymore. You don't have the interactions with the people that you love when you want them and need them. You have no influence. It seems like so much is out of your control. We minister to that social weakness as well. Sometimes it's with humor. I have this humor therapy thing that's been going on with me for a long time. You saw how I started the service. I can't help it. It just kind of happens. I don't know why. I've walked into cardiac care units where people have just come off life support and they're standing there and I look and everyone's face is drawn and haggard and everything else, and I'll look at the fellow lying in the bed and say something absolutely ridiculous like, "Oh, I bet you'd rather be fishing." And they laugh. And then all the other people relax and they know they're going to be fine, because healing, you have to be at least whole spiritually to be able to laugh at your problems or even in the midst of your problems. But that social weakness usually leads to frustration and anger and lashing out to general behaviors that we're not very proud of. And then the shame raises another barrier to recovering our health. But there's another aspect of weakness that we minister to in the hospital, and it'll shock you. It's moral weakness. Yes, sometimes moral weakness is at the root of our diseases and our problems, right? We do things that we shouldn't do, and we know that we shouldn't do them, so we don't have that moral character to say no to ourselves, right? I'm not blaming the sick for their sickness, but I can talk from my own experience about that. The extra cookie that I didn't need that becomes the whole box of cookies, and then I got a lot of pain in places, and I start to think about my family's diabetes history and the heart problems. You get where I'm going. All those awful announcements outside the hospital door about smoking, you know, it contends almost with how many announcements there are about how to find your way into the hospital from the parking lot. And it's that kind of thing. But there's another aspect about the moral weakness of humanity that we have to minister to, and it's called systemic monstrosity. The healthcare system has some moral weaknesses in it too, and we don't know how to correct them. Overgrown administrations that just keep growing and growing. How do you stop that from growing? Drug therapies that worked for one, and now they go on and on and on, overused and overused. People whose wishes are ignored, even though they've written them down and said to doctors and family, "Don't do this and don't do that," and all of a sudden, they're in the midst of all those don'ts. Prognoses, where it just completely overreaches what is humanly possible to actually be sure of and to know, when things are said that should never be said. And policies that are totalizing and overarching as though they could actually fit every circumstance. Oh my goodness, are we God? There's our moral weakness right from the beginning. We are not. Care of the church for the sick in the hospital. government does not support what I do. The government does not support what Luminous does. It's the other way around. This is David, not Goliath. We're the little people. And the government has decided they want to count on the little people to do the big work. They want the church to do the spiritual care, which we don't do anyway. That's based in psychotherapy. Pastoral care is based in the Bible. That's the difference right there. So, Paul, in that situation, he says, likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. The likewise harkens back to everything else that he said in chapter 8. And if you get time when you go home after the service, get out your Bible and read chapter 8. You'll not understand a lot of it, because I don't, and I've studied it all my life. And you'll have other insights about it that I don't have. And that's what's so precious about the Scriptures, and that the Holy Spirit helps us in our weakness. Because then we have to share with one another what the Spirit has said to us, and that's the help of the community of saints. And we'll see that over and over again in chapter 8. The Holy Spirit sets us free from the law of sin and death so that we can live in Christ. The Holy Spirit in that same way helps us in whatever weakness we're experiencing. The Holy Spirit sets our minds on life and peace rather than death and the flesh. In that same way, the Holy Spirit helps us in our weakness. The Holy Spirit dwells in us, and by dwelling in us, brings Christ to dwell in us. In the same way, the Holy Spirit helps us in our weakness. The Holy Spirit crucifies us to sin and raises us to new life, even raising us from the dead on the last day. In the same way, likewise, the Holy Spirit helps us in our weakness. The Holy Spirit helps us leave behind the life of the flesh and to deal with our problems in our bodies, our bad habits, so to speak. In the same way, the Holy Spirit helps us in our weakness. The Holy Spirit leads us to live for God rather than ourselves. And in the same way, the Holy Spirit helps us in our weakness. And the Holy Spirit bears witness with our spirit when we cry out to God, Our Father, Abba, Father. So in that way, the Holy Spirit helps us in our weakness. I think that's what Paul means by likewise. And it hangs on that prayer. Abba, Father, our Father. Pray. So that's what he says. For we do not know how to pray as we ought, but the Spirit intercedes for us with sighs too deep for words. When I visit people in the hospital, they often want to be prayed with. Sometimes they ask very directly. Other times you just see that longing for prayer in their eyes. Too often, before a prayer happens in the pastoral care process, it's interrupted by the packed schedule of a doctor or the arrival of friends or family or a nursing intervention that has to take place. Of course, we go out of the room and finish the prayer on our own, either as we're walking down the hall to the next patient or up in the chapel if it's something heavy on our heart. But the person in their weakness has not heard the prayer. It seems that God comes to us through actual words of prayer, actually hearing, or hearing a scripture passage read for ourselves, actually joining a hand, joins the heart in that fervent, ardent prayer. These are the vital means by which the Spirit of God helps us in our weakness. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we ought to. He's implying that we need to pray together. As Jesus promised, where two or three are gathered together in my name, there I am in the midst of them. It surprises me how often people know exactly what they want to pray for. When I say, what would you like me to pray for? They can list three or four things, or one thing perhaps that's really important, but they still need help formulating that request into a prayer. And I think that's a sign of another kind of weakness that we minister to and that I bring into the hospital as well, and often receive help and strength from the patient. Our spiritual weakness when we're in a time of crisis. I've experienced that as a caregiver, and I've experienced it as the one needing care. It's also strange how often the prayers, not the prayers, but the prayers, the people praying, formulate a prayer that begins with a deep sigh. Have you noticed that? Sometimes even at dinner time, when you start to say a prayer for the meal, you start with a sigh. Isn't that true? And that's not just because you're searching for words and don't know what to say. It's because of what Paul said, the Holy Spirit intercedes for us with sighs too deep for words. And how are we going to hear the Holy Spirit sigh unless we sigh? Watch for that. You'll be amazed how often prayer starts a deep sigh. I've especially experienced that with people I pray with when they're close to death. It's also amazing to me how often the words of the prayer, the person praying, those words that are spoken out loud directly speak to the needs that the patient has expressed in the conversation, or maybe even not expressed. But why should we be surprised? Because the one who searches hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to God's will. It's the Holy Spirit who is helping us in our weakness, not me, not the prayer. The chaplain and the prayer, the volunteers, the visitors, the nurses who stop and pray, the doctors who pray before surgery, all of them, and the whole support network too, from my hospital chaplaincy, luminous, from the prayer and financial supporters all the way through the organization of the chaplaincy up to the annual general meeting. These are the form of the office of the Word and Sacrament as the means by which the Holy Spirit offers this help in our weakness in the hospital. It seems, according to Paul, that one of the causes, if you're okay with thinking about it as a cause, one of the causes of our weakness is a lack of advanced knowledge of our faith. Now, this is the most frequently encountered spiritual problem in the hospital. People have faith in Christ, but that faith has not grown, not for a very long time, because these people have neither fed nor exercised their faith. Now they're in a crisis. They're afraid of losing their faith because they're afraid that it's not up to the burden they now have to carry. Many times over these past 10 years as a chaplain, people have told me what good Christians they are, even though they never go to church anymore. Some of them even confide in me, and I totally believe them, that they read their Bible and they pray every day. And I encourage them to do this, especially while they're in the hospital. I'll go and get them a Bible. Theirs didn't come with them. Thank you to the Gideons. And I'll bring them prayer flyers as well, in case they run out of words for themselves. And I'll pray with them and I'll come back, because that's a crisis, and people pray in a crisis. And as we pray in our crisis, maybe some of that will help us deepen and grow our faith. The Scripture is one of the primary ways in which God speaks to us. However, there's another way, and that's the sacraments. That's the sacraments. And I know it's you and Judy celebrate the sacraments in your home, but I bet there aren't very many of us in the congregation that do that. And there are very few of the folks that tell me that they pray or read their Bible every day that have been to communion before they were at the hospital. 50% of the Lutherans that I see can't be the current pastor of their home congregation. That's why I'm there. That's why I need your support, the support of all the congregations in the province, so that when they're confronted with that, the Spirit can come and help them in their weakness. Because God, the Holy Spirit, always works through means. It doesn't just come out of nowhere. The Holy Spirit needs words of prayers, words of Scripture, memories of services, times when God acted and renewed it. Those kind of things are essential for the Holy Spirit to And if we're to grow in our faith, we need to go back to the places where that will be fed and nourished and exercised. And this is that place. Probably, increasingly, the only place in our society. Here, the sacraments of communion and baptism, not out on the street, and very rarely in the hospital. Yes, we think first about the pastor coming, bringing the Holy Communion, but what about the baptism? Well, how is that practiced? Well, when I do a bedside communion, I always begin it with a confession of some form, brief, even briefer than the one we used. And even before the words of grace and forgiveness are experienced, a person in the bed or a family member nearby who hasn't practiced this sacrament of baptism for a long time, already the tears are starting to form. And then by the time we get to the bread and the wine, we can hardly speak the Lord's Prayer with us because of the emotion. Can you imagine not having had communion for 30 years? And then being in a hospital, and having a chaplain like me come and say after a second or third visit, would you like to receive the Lord's Supper? I had one person tell me after the communion when they could get their voice back, they told me they had never had Holy Communion in their life. Imagine, just imagine living our faith without that. Hearts are stirred and faith begins to grow. And that moment by moment reassurance of forgiveness that we receive by being able to just speak to the Lord, oh Lord, forgive me, I blew that one. I know again that Christ died for that little sin. What a difference that makes in our daily lives. We have no idea how important the practice of baptism is, that sacrament. And the presence of Jesus that we have here in bread and wine when we celebrate the Lord's Supper together, that presence goes with us. It's in our bodies through the bread and the wine, the body and blood. Jesus dwells in us by the power of the Holy Spirit. What a difference that makes in the way we respond at the four-way stop sign when the guy is raging at us, or at the workplace where someone's made a mistake, or you know what I'm saying? The Spirit is moving deep within to help grow our faith for those moments. And then Paul goes on to provide a very difficult teaching which challenges even the most mature faith to grow more. The next verse expresses some of the most difficult theological concepts brings us to the limit of what we can know and understand about our Christian faith. The knowledge that Paul is speaking of in these verses is what we call wisdom. It's named in our song. It's a knowledge that derives from reflecting on experience, and one particular experience of suffering, experience of sharing cross of Jesus. From this, we know that in everything God works for good for those who love Him. It's not a theory. Why? Why, Pastor? I'm asked that almost every day. Why do I have to go through this? Just listen to the way it's phrased. Have to go through this. What did I do? Why is God doing this to me? I was trained in psychotherapy and spiritual care to reframe the question. In other words, to invalidate it. In my Bible training, I've learned that's exactly the right question. That's the God-sized question. It's the question that opens up my mind and my heart to the Holy Spirit's answer. Never again do I deny that question's validity. I sit with that painful, painful question until it aches in my soul, until I hear it as my own question about my own little sufferings in life compared to what I've shared with the person in bed or the history that's being told to me. Why? Now hear Paul's answer. It will challenge your faith to grow. Because God is working with you through this for good. For your those you love, for the good of the whole creation, for the good of the kingdom of God. You are suffering with Christ. You may not even know Christ. That makes it very hard to suffer with Christ. But you are now suffering with Christ, and Christ with you. In fact, Paul even goes further than that. If that didn't challenge you enough, Paul says, this moment is what God has called you to. I have never had the courage to say that to someone else, which means my faith has to grow. These are very difficult words, but they are words of infinite grace. The grace of Jesus on the cross, crucified for the sins of the world and for our redemption. These are frightening words, but they bring comfort to frightened souls and frightening situations. For what comfort is it to really know that we are not suffering these things for any fault of our own, and not having to carry them on our own strength, but that Christ is with us. Christ on the cross, Christ crucified, Christ suffering, Christ really present in our suffering bodies and in our agonizing spirits. When we cry, Abba, Father, it is the Spirit of God crying out in us with our spirit. And that cry affirms that we are God's children even in our suffering. This reassurance not only reinforces our relationship with God now in the midst of our suffering, but also our hope of eternal glory. Amen. Can we say amen? But Paul even goes beyond this. He dares to say that this moment of anguish was planned before we were born. The complete, total plan of God, predestined before the beginning of the universe, because it helps us to be like Christ. For those he predestined, he also called. And those he called, he also justified. Those he justified, he also glorified. I was on a trip with two of the boys. We went to Germany and saw some of the places where Martin Luther wrote. Just off our track when we couldn't get there was a place where the Lutheran Confession was presented a few years after 1517. This is the 500th anniversary of the beginning of the Reformation, but it's certainly not the end. Still in it. Five times this passage from Romans that I've been talking about today, and you've been working so patiently with me through, five times it's quoted and expanded on in our Lutheran confessions. And I'd like to conclude by reading one of the places that refers to this passage near the end of a very thick book called the Book of Concord. In the document called the Formula of Concord, Solid Declaration, the article on the election of God's people. This is a very useful and comforting teaching, for it confirms most powerfully that we become righteous and are saved completely apart from all our works and deeds, purely on the basis of grace, solely for the sake of Christ. For before time began, even previous to our own existence, indeed, before the foundation of the world, Ephesians chapter 1, verse 4, certainly before we had been able to do anything good, we were chosen for salvation by grace in Christ, according to God's intention. See Romans 9, verse 11, and 2 Timothy 1, verse 9. This also refutes all opinions and false teaching concerning the powers of our natural will. Since before time began, God considered and preordained in his counsel that he himself would create and effect everything in us that belongs to our conversion by the power of the Holy Spirit through the Word. This teaching also offers a beautiful comfort. God made the conversion, the righteousness, and the salvation of each individual Christian such a high personal concern, and intended to remain so faithful to it, that even before the foundation of the world, God resolved, and according to his own purpose, preordained how to bring me to salvation and preserve me in it. Please put your own name in that place. Likewise, God desired to guarantee my salvation so completely and certainly, because it could slip through our fingers so easily, through weakness and wickedness of our flesh, or be snatched and taken away from our hands through the deceit and power of the devil and the world. For God has preordained this salvation through his eternal intention, which cannot fail or be overthrown. And God has placed it for safekeeping into the almighty hand of our Savior Jesus Christ, from which no one can snatch us away. John 10, verse 28. Therefore, Paul also asks in Romans 8, verse 28, 35, and 39, since we are called in accord with God's plan, who will separate us from the love of God in Christ? This also gives us wonderful comfort in crosses and trials, that in God's counsel before time began, he determined and decreed that he would stand by us in every trouble, grant us patience, give us comfort, create hope, and provide a way out of all things that we may be saved. See 1 Corinthians 10, verse 13. Likewise, Paul treats this matter in such a comforting way in Romans 8, pointing out that in his intention before time began, God preordained what sort of crosses and sufferings he will use to conform each one of us to the image of his Son, and that the cross of each should and must work together for the good of that person, because we are called according to his purpose. On this basis, Paul concluded with certainty and without doubt that neither hardship nor distress, neither death nor life, will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. Thanks be to God.
Amen.
When we're ready, our hymn of the day is In Christ Alone.
Thank you.
So Christ be with you all.
Yeah.
Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to your needs. We give you thanks, Heavenly Father, for Jesus Christ, your only Son, our Lord, that you have poured out your grace and mercy upon us. That you have called us to be your own. Gather us into your church. And by the power of the Holy Spirit in us, enable us to worship and praise your holy name this morning. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for your church throughout the world, especially all the congregations in this community and our brother and sister congregations and Lutheran churches. We ask that your word of grace and truth will resound among us, and your sacraments of baptism and Holy Communion be celebrated in the forgiveness of sins until the last of all. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the leaders of the nations, that they refine the path of peace through the Prince of Peace. Especially we pray for the leaders of this nation, this province, this community, and this congregation. Inspire in us, by the power of your Holy Spirit, a genuine desire for the path of peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all those who have been called by your grace into the ministry of healing, body, mind, soul, and spirit. We pray that it would be your hands working through their hands, your love working through their compassion, your skill working through their minds. That your people may know the wholeness that we promise through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our brothers and sisters, those that we know are in crisis and have asked or whose names have been impressed upon our hearts that we may pray for them. We name them now in the silence of our hearts or aloud before your throne of mercy. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We give you thanks, Almighty God, for the work of hospital chaplaincy, especially in this time of uncertainty, as government policy changes due to the expenses of the years. And we ask, O Lord, that you would especially work with those in the healthcare system who have tried to make their lives to give them comfort and care to others who will lose their positions, and to bless the work of those who are needy. We thank you for denominational chaplaincies that are supported in the United Church of Canada, the Roman Catholic Diocese of Saskatoon, the Anglican Diocese of Kell in Northern Saskatchewan, and the Lutheran Church Canada, which we can tell the Lutheran Church in Canada for goodness. We pray your blessing on all those who visit the sick. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We give you thanks, Lord, for our brothers and sisters of faith, for Shane and Heather, Julia and Yvonne, Mark and Heather, Bob and Yvonne, and for all those that you call to ministries in your church. We especially pray that we will bring renewal and healing to our pastor and family as they take time away from us here and are renewed by that. All these things and whatever else you see in me, we lift up before you through our Savior Jesus Christ, praying as he himself is taught, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory. Remember that. blessing of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. Amen. Please be seated. Are there any announcements from the gathering?
I just have this one about your welcome communication card. There's feedback, requests, and prayer needs on the back. And as a guest visitor today, I'd really appreciate it if you have any feedback. You can write it, leave it in the offering plate today or next week, or maybe with Pastor Mark when he comes back, and he'll be sure to get in touch with me. Or any requests or referrals for people that you know that are in hospital or going to hospital, or people that you know that are Lutheran, that are separated from congregations, and are ill, I can go and visit them. That's part of my mandate. So please use that. It's on the welcome table at the back. Let's conclude our service then. Let's conclude our worship service, but not our service. So we stand to sing, Blessed Be Your Name.
Peace, love, and serve the Lord.